Hi, thanks for joining me today. My name is Paul Martin, and I'm the founder of College Money Method, an educational service focused on supporting students and their family to be successful in the financial aid process through workshops, content, and individual advising. Today, I'm excited to present to you a start-to-finish walkthrough of the FAFSA, which is the free application for federal student aid. In this 25-minute video, I will be filling out the application as a student and go screen by screen to show you how to answer the questions successfully so that you can submit the application. Completing the FAFSA is important because the FAFSA does three things. One, it determines your eligibility for federal student aid, such as federal Pell Grants or federal student loans. Two, it calculates your expected family contribution, which is the application's determination of your family's ability to pay for college. And three, it will send the application information to all the colleges you want to apply for financial aid to ensure they have information to determine whether you qualify for their institutional awards and grants as well. Before we get started, let's review the documents and financial statements you'll need to successfully complete the application. It's best if you can have these all with you, printed out or saved, so you can get through the application more quickly.
Parents will need their Social Security number, as well as U.S. tax returns from 2021, W-2 forms from their employer from 2021, and any records of untaxed income earned in 2021. In order to fill out the assets section, you're going to need today's financial statements from checking, savings, any brokerage accounts that are non-retirement investments, 529 or other educational savings plans, annuities, trusts, and if you own second properties, you'll have to have the equity value of those second properties. Students will need their Social Security number, driver's license, any income earned in 2021, whether it's through the U.S. tax return or other types of income, and W-2 forms if they were employed. To fill out the assets section, students will need today's balances from checking, savings, and any non-retirement investments they may have, like brokerage accounts, as well as trusts or UGMA or UTMA account balances.
While you don't want to delay in filling out the application, if you're feeling stressed, overwhelmed, or stuck, remember, you can save your progress and come back to the application the next day. You don't want to rush through the application. You want to provide the accurate information and give yourself the best opportunity to afford your college dream. So let's get started.
When you arrive at the welcome screen for the FAFSA form, you'll see it ask you who's filling out the application. In this case, I'll be filling out the application as a student, but if you are a parent filling out FAFSA for your student, you'll notice you'll need additional information, including the student's Social Security number, so that the information you input will be collected in that student's FAFSA application. The login screen asks you to log in with your student FSA ID username, email or mobile number, and your student FSA ID password. On the Getting Started screen, you can see it asks you which school year you're applying for financial aid. Be careful to choose the right FAFSA form. If you're starting school next year for the term 23-24, you want to make sure you're using the FAFSA form for financial aid year 23-24. Next screen asks you to create a save key. A save key will allow you to pause your work and come back and complete the FAFSA at any time. Remember to write down your save key because you'll need this in order to restart your application from where you left off. The introduction screen gives you various resources you can access in order to help you complete the FAFSA. The FAFSA form is divided into 7 sections, which you can see along the top of the form. I'll be walking you through each section on how to complete the information. Remember, after you complete a section, the application auto-saves at the end of that section. But at any time, if you want to pause your progress on FAFSA, you can save your FAFSA form, exit the FAFSA form, and come back at a later date using your save key to complete the FAFSA. The first screen is student information, which is personal information about the student, which was entered when the student created the FSA ID. One important thing to remember about this form is regardless if you're logged in as a parent or a student, you and yours will always refer to the student, which can be confusing at times, particularly for parents filling out the form on behalf of their student. So be careful to understand which section you're in and understand the term you and yours is referring to the student. The student's email address will be automatically transferred from their FSA ID information. If you want to include your phone number, you can do it at this time. The student's address will also be transferred from their FSA ID registration. If it happens to be blank, you can enter the information now. Student will answer information about their residency and eligibility. The first question pertains to the state which where they lived. If the student has not lived in their current state for at least 5 years, they'll have to answer a series of other questions about prior states of residence. In addition, the student has to identify whether they're a U.S. citizen, an eligible non-citizen, or not a citizen, or an eligible non-citizen.
Here is a summary of eligible non-citizens, but you can also use the question mark button next to the drop-down to read more about that directly on the FAFSA website.
If the student is an eligible non-citizen, they will be required to enter their alien registration number at this point. This screen will ask questions about the student's current education. The first question is what the high school completion status will be when they begin college next year. The next question will be about the type of degree or certificate they'll be earning in their post-secondary pursuit next year during the 23-24 school year. And importantly, it's going to ask what grade level they will be beginning next school year. Now, this can be a tricky question for some students if they've taken college credits during high school or in dual enrolled. But in fact, if you're a high school senior graduating and entering college full-time for the first time next year, you will answer never attended college first year, even if you have college credits coming into that school year. This is because it's going to be the first full school year which you're receiving federal student aid. The final question will ask whether you're interested in work study. If you have a driver's license, you enter the information now. The final screen for student demographics will ask whether the student has been in foster care at any time, as well as what's the highest school completed by both of their parents. If you're answering this question and your parent earned their degrees outside the US, you want to use the highest completion in their native country. And if you don't know your parent's highest school degree, you can choose other or unknown. The school selection section will ask you about your current high school, as well as the colleges for which you want to apply for financial aid. On the first screen, you're going to add the high school you attended. You have to choose a state, and then you can type in the name of that high school. You'll choose your high school from the database and hit continue. Now you're on the college search screen. Remember, when you're applying for financial aid through FAFSA, you can only enter 10 colleges at a time on this form. And it tells you a little bit about this at the top. But don't worry, if you're going to be applying for financial aid to more than 10 colleges, you should put your first 10 colleges in the form. And then when you receive confirmation from that college or colleges that they've received your FAFSA form, you could come back and delete those colleges that have received the form and enter a new set of colleges. You're going to search for colleges using a database where you're required to select the college's state, and then you can search by school name. You're going to choose the college for which you're applying for financial aid and hit continue. It's going to ask you what housing plan you have while you're in college your first year. I suggest most students choose on campus in order to get the full financial aid package, which would include on-campus housing. Now, if you need to add more schools, you're going to do that at this point before hitting continue by hitting the add more schools button, and you could select additional schools. Now, remember, you can add up to 10 schools at this point, and once you've hit 10 schools, you're going to be asked to continue. We're on the third section now, which is about dependency status, which determines whether a student can apply for financial aid on their own or whether to be considered for financial aid, they have to include their parents' information as well. So first question is about students' marital status. The second two questions ask whether the student themselves has either dependent children or other dependents. Now here's a series of questions which can help determine whether a student can apply as an independent student. The first two questions pertain to whether the student is either actively in the military or a veteran of the armed forces. The third question asks whether after the age of 13, the student's parents were deceased, whether they're in foster care or dependent or ward of the court. The fourth question asks whether a court in their state of residence determined that they were emancipated minor. And the final question that can be relevant for some students is whether they're under court-appointed legal guardianship under an adult other than their parent or step-parent.
If none of these apply to you, choose none of the above.
The last screen asks about a student's homelessness status and whether they are homeless or were self-supporting or at risk of being homeless after July 1st of 2022. You can see here on this final screen of dependency status, it has determined that I am considered a dependent student, which means that I will be required to submit parent information in order for my FAFSA to be fully processed and colleges to consider me for financial aid. Section 4 is called parent demographics, and it's where I'll answer information about my parent or parents. Importantly, FAFSA has specific rules as to which parent should be reporting information on the FAFSA, especially in cases of separation or divorce. On this screen, you'll report your parents' marital status. You'll choose from the drop-down menu. In this case, I'm gonna report my parents have been divorced and separated, and I'm gonna have to enter the month and year of the separation. In this case, the mother is the custodial parent, so I'll be providing her information on this application. The next section is information about your mother, which should include the Social Security number, last name, date of birth, and if your mother wants to receive updates about FAFSA, your mother's email address. This next screen asks about your parents' state of legal residence. If your parent doesn't live in the same state as you or lives in another country, you would answer that question here. This screen can be a little tricky because it's asking about your mother's dependents, both including dependent children and other dependents who might live with your mom. Remember to read the questions carefully because the dependent children reported will need to continue in your mother's household next year while you're in college from July 1st, 2023 to June 30th, 2024. And that child has to receive more than half their financial support from your mother, as well as the fact that they have to answer no to all the dependency status questions that are standard on the FAFSA form. You can use the pop-up to see what those questions are to determine whether a child living at home can qualify as a dependent child. And importantly, in this screen, you do not include yourself when you're reporting the number of dependent children. So if you have one brother, you would only report one here. You do not report two. If there are other dependents living with your mom now, receive half their support from your mom, and will continue to do so next year, you want to put them here. This could be elderly grandparents or others who may still be living at home. This screen summarizes information about your mom's household, your parents' household, which includes you, your mother, your brother, and another dependent living in your parents' home. Now, this question is tricky as well because it's asking for the number of dependents who are in college next year. And in this case, you do include yourself. So in my case, I'm the only one in college, but if myself and my brother were both in college next year, the answer would be 2 here. But again, because I'm the only one in college, the answer is 1. Now we are on the section where we have to answer questions about our parents' financials. This section is divided into 2 main parts. The first part will ask about parent income, and the final screen will ask about parent assets. Remember, when you're reporting information about income for FAFSA, you're going to report only information about income for 2021. You can see clearly here it's asking for 2021 tax returns, but there are going to be additional questions about income, and you need to make sure you're only reporting information from 2021. When we get to the asset section, I'll be sure to call out the information you need to report and from what time period, which should be assets and balances as of the value today. The first question will ask you whether your mother has already completed her IRS tax return. You're going to choose between already completed, will file, or not going to file. If it is the case that your parents don't file US tax returns, you can choose not going to file, and you'll be asked specific questions about income in the following screens so that you can substitute that income for the federal tax return information. She used IRS Form 1040, which is the dominant form most US citizens use. And you have to find your mother's tax filing status, which is checked at the top of the tax form. In this case, she's not remarried, so she files a single tax form. At this point, you do have the opportunity to enter all the information that comes from your tax form directly from the IRS using the IRS data retrieval tool. Now, in order to do this, you'll need your parents' participation because they will have to log in order for the IRS to securely transfer that data using their information from the database. The first screen asks for your mom's adjusted gross income for 2021. You can easily find this information on her tax return under line 11, and you could see here that FAFSA has pop-ups to show you exactly where to find this information on the tax return. So you can enter information from line 11 here. It's important to know also that every one of these screens has this question mark in tooltip, which will allow you to quickly find information that you may need to enter on different forms that your parents have. This second screen asks about your mom's earnings, specifically from work, whether it's an employer or other source, through wages, salaries, and tips. The first place you can look is on your parents' W-2 form in boxes 1 and 8, will have the total amount of parent earning for last year in 2021. Or you can use the pop-up to find these numbers on the tax forms. Here you enter the amount of income tax your mom paid in 2021. Again, you can use the pop-up to see exactly where to find this, which is on page 2 of 1040, line 22. This screen asks about additional sources of income that your mom might have had last year. Now, I'll walk you through this. This is a lot of questions and can be a little overwhelming, but there's an easy way to break this down to determine whether there are numbers you need to put in each section. The first question asks specifically about parents who are in combat or special combat and receive pay. If your parents weren't in combat, that should automatically be 0. The second question asks about grants and scholarships that your mom might have received or your parents might have received by going to college or graduate school. So if your parents weren't in college or graduate school last year, that's going to be zero. The third question asks about education credits that they might have received through their tax form. Now, if none of your brothers and sisters are in college last year, or your parents weren't in college in 2021 or in graduate school, there's a good chance that they didn't receive this tax credit. But if you want to make sure, check to see if they have a Schedule 3 filed with their taxes and look under line 3. The fourth question asks about untaxed portions from their retirement accounts that they may have received. Now, it's easy to find this number. You can see on the form, it tells you exactly where to look, which is box 4A and 5A, and then you have boxes 4B and 5B. Follow the formula if there are numbers in that in order to come up with a calculation, but be careful to exclude rollovers. We never want to report rollovers. The fifth question asks about IRA deductions and payments to self-employment. So this would be one where if your parents did schedule one of the 1040, you can simply look at lines 16 and lines 20 to see if there are values there. There are values in both, you add them together and put the number here. And the final one is if they've received tax-exempt interest. This can be found on the very first page of the 1040 under line 2A. Enter an amount there if it does exist. If you have zeros for all of these, that is completely acceptable. There's a good chance that none of these apply to your parent. Once you've entered the values, you can hit continue. This screen has three additional financial questions about 2021. The first question will ask whether your parent that's reporting on the application, in this case your mother, paid out child support due to divorce or separation. If there were no child support payments made, then you would enter zero here. The second two questions, again, would only apply if your parent was in college or in graduate program and they were earning money through a co-op or through other need-based employment programs. If your parents weren't in school last year, the answers are gonna be zero here. Now, this final screen has a number of questions which can be overwhelming again, but I'll walk you through how to answer these questions for 2021. The first question asks whether your parent has received child support from an ex-spouse in 2021. If they are receiving child support, you'd enter amount here. The second question pertains to parents who are in the military, clergy, and are receiving housing, food, and other living allowance that are not reported on as a benefit on their tax form. If that would be the case, you'd enter a value here. Now, this third question is more common and could very well apply to your family. What this is asking about any contributions your parent has made through their employer, which were not taxed. Now, you have to have a specific form, the W-2 form, in order to find this information. But if you have your parents' W-2 form, you could look this information up there. It shows you here which box to look in, which is box 12A through 12D, and any numbers that have the codes D, E, F, G, H, or S should be reported here and added together. However, if there is a code DD in this section and there's an amount next to it, we do not want to report that. You will only report the codes that are listed here. The fourth question only applies if your parent is a veteran and is receiving non-education benefits. If they are, you'd put that amount here. And the final question is untaxed income that's not reporting on the tax form, such as workers' comp, disability benefits, etc. You may want to ask your parents about this, but for most families, this is not going to apply. We've completed all the information about income for your parent or parents, but now we have to answer questions about assets. And it's important to remember when you're answering these questions, you're going to use values in the accounts as of today, the date of filing for FAFSA. For the first question, you report the current amount in your mother or parents' checking and savings account. Enter that amount in the first box. For the second box, you're going to answer
What are the account values of your mother's investments, not including your primary home or retirement accounts? You can refer to the list of documents you'll need, and you can check for statements of brokerage, which are non-retirement investments only, 529 and other educational savings plan, annuities and trust, as well as equity value of second properties. Enter that total amount in the second line. The final question would only apply if your mom owns a business and has greater than 100 full-time employees. If your mom does have a business or your parents do have a business like that, they would have to get a valuation of their business in order to enter that here. Most family businesses are smaller than 100 full-time employees, and so the value here would be zero. Congratulations, we've gone through probably the hardest part of the application, which is the parent financials. This final section would be information about student financials, and you're gonna answer questions about any money you earn or money you may have in your accounts. Remember, when we're talking about money we've earned, we're only reporting income or money earned in 2021. So similarly, you're gonna answer whether you have completed a tax return or not. Many students don't earn enough money to complete a tax return, but they might have earned some money in 2021. In this case, you choose not going to file. It's gonna ask you in the first screen how much you've earned from working. That could be from an employer through wages and salaries, or maybe you've worked on the side as a babysitter, etc. You wanna put your total earnings for 2021 here. The next three questions about your income will be very specific cases. The first question will only apply if you paid out child support. The second two questions would only apply if you earn money in college. Now, if you're a first-time applicant, you wouldn't have earned money through a cooperative program or other need-based employment programs in college, so these will all be zero. This final screen about potential income in 2021 is similar to the questions asked for your parents, but you're going to be answering them for yourself. And most of these are going to be zero because of the type of questions that are being asked. The exceptions could be that you have contributed to retirement through your employer, which would be question number three. Again, you could look at your W-2, if you have an employer W-2, to see if there are values in box 12 that meet specific letter codes D, E, F, G, H, and S. And the final question could apply for you if you've received money or had bills paid on your behalf from relatives who aren't in your immediate family. That amount should be reported here as untaxed income. Now, this final screen is about account balances you may hold as of today. So remember, you're going to report values as of today. The first question is about your checking and savings accounts. Put the value here. If you have other investments outside checking and savings, maybe you have a couple stocks you own or other types of investments, you'd put that value here. And finally, similar to your parents, if you own a business and you have greater than 100 full-time employees, you'd have to put the value of that business here. This is the summary screen of all the information you've entered so far. This is a great place to check your work and make sure all the information is correct. And importantly, if you have to change any information, you could simply use the links here to go back to that specific question within a section and revise your information. I also really recommend you print out a summary of the screen, which is at the bottom. Now let's hit continue to get this application submitted. You'll be asked a series of questions before signing and submitted about your gender, whether you consider yourself transgender, your ethnicity, as well as your race. So we're ready to sign electronically. We first have to read the terms of receiving federal student aid and agree to those terms. Once I agree to those terms, I can sign the FAFSA form electronically. By clicking this button, you'll have signed your FAFSA form. At this point, I'm logged in as a student. It's gonna ask for a parent signature to finalize the application and have the application complete and submitted.
So if we want to provide a parent signature now, we can click on this button and have our parent read the terms of submitting the application, agree to those terms, and hit continue. And then it will ask the parent to log in with their FSA ID and password. And once they've logged in and hit sign and submit, the application will be signed and submitted. Now, if it turns out your parent doesn't have a social security number and was not able to create an FSA ID, there are other options to submit the FAFSA. You can click on the other options to sign and submit, and you could see here, you can print a signature page, which will allow you to print out the application and have your parent sign the application. Once your parents sign the FAFSA using their FSID and password, you'll get to the congratulations screen. So congratulations, you've submitted the FAFSA. There's details on what will happen next, as well as if you scroll down, you will see your expected family contribution that has been calculated based off of information you've entered into the FAFSA. In this case, because it's a demo account, I'm getting all nines, but you'll get a specific number which colleges will use to determine your need and additional institutional aid that they can support you with. Below, you also get estimated eligibility information for the federal student aid programs you qualify for. So be sure to keep this, print out this page so you have a record of these information.
Now that you've completed the application, I want to congratulate you. You've taken a huge first step in the financial aid process and are on your way to affording your college dream. If you want more information about the process, you can go to studentaid.gov, which is the federal website dedicated to financial aid. All the best on your financial aid journey and achieving your college dream.